Hi, my name is Daniel Hall. I'm a general surgeon at the VA Pittsburgh. I'm here to explain how you can get involved with preoperative frailty screening and prehabilitation. In this brief presentation, I want to help get you up to speed. I'll outline the problem of surgical frailty, describe how what we call the surgical pause can be a solution to that problem, and then I'll review some of the outcomes we've observed after implementing the surgical pause. And after setting that background, I'll explain the process for RAI assessment, demonstrate the RAI tool, and review how the RAI can integrate into CPRS. So first, the problem. There is a growing body of research that confirms what I suspect you have always known at an intuitive level. Frail patients suffer disproportionately higher rates of adverse postoperative complications, including death, disability, readmission, extended length of stay, and long-term institutionalization. Unfortunately, surgeons have not had a consistent process for routinely screening patients for frailty. Sure, we have always kept an eye out for the cachectic little old lady struggling with a walker, but data demonstrate that we are much more likely to identify at-risk patients if we systematically screen for it with a proven tool. As such, there is a need for an easy-to-administer, standardized screening tool to better inform the selection of high-risk patients considering elective surgery. To address the need for such a standardized screening tool, my colleagues and I developed the Risk Analysis Index, or RAI. The tool was initially developed and validated out of the Omaha VA, but we have subsequently validated it in a national sample in both VA and private sectors. Here's the idea. When a new patient presents to a clinic, the first thing that we want to do is measure frailty with the RAI. Most people will screen as robust, and for this 90 to 95% of your surgical volume, you don't need to do anything different. These low-risk, robust people can proceed as usual to the rapid and effective care that they get in our operating rooms. And because they score low on the RAI, we can be confident that they will experience surgical outcomes similar to or better than the national averages published in the surgical literature. But for that 5 to 10% of the population that screens as potentially frail, we want to stop the assembly line. We want to call a surgical pause during which we make no promises to the patient about treatment or timing. Instead, we want to explain that they might benefit from further risk assessment and mitigation, perhaps at a multidisciplinary clinic. And they should spend the time necessary to engage the patient in a robust, risk-informed shared decision-making process aimed at ensuring that the chosen and recommended treatment aligns with patient values. Some patients will likely elect non-operative management when they're informed of their perioperative risks, and we can facilitate their care of this non-operative management. But most will go on to have surgery because they still stand to benefit. But in the 3 to 5 weeks it usually takes to find an open day in the operating room schedule, these patients might benefit from focused interventions aimed at building strength, endurance, and nutrition through what we call prehabilitation. So what happens when and if you do this? At the Omaha VA, 180-day mortality among the frail fell from 24% to less than 8% in a matter of 6 months. That corresponds to a nearly threefold survival advantage after controlling for age, frailty, and multiple comorbidity. And we replicated these findings both at the VA Pittsburgh and the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, where, as you can see here, mortality was stable until July 2016, when we started assessing frailty on all patients presenting to outpatient surgery clinics, that is, the first vertical line, at which point the mortality started to drop. Mortality dropped even faster in February of 2018 when we started asking surgeons to do something different for the patients with elevated RAI scores. Bottom line is that this simple intervention works, and it works dramatically. Part of the reason it works is that it's really easy. We've done it more than 400,000 times now across multiple hospitals. It takes less than 30 seconds, and it does not disrupt the flow of your clinic. Here's how you do it. When patients arrive in the clinic and check in, you give them this one-page patient-facing version of the RAI that has all the questions written in eighth grade English. The patient then completes the survey to the best of their ability while in the waiting room, with or without the assistance of their companion. Then, when you move the patient into the exam room, a nurse or medical assistant reviews the responses, corrects any that contradict their clinical judgment, and keys the values into an online calculator that can be loaded onto any VA browser behind the VA firewall. That's it. Let me show you. So this is what the online RAI looks like, and something like this would open up in your browser. As we scroll down, we'll see that the first question pertains to age. Let's make this patient 87, and then mark that they're male. First question is, does this patient live in a nursing home? The answer is no. Has this patient ever seen a nephrologist, that's a kidney doctor, or have any history of kidney problems? Let's answer this yes. And since it's hard to know whether this is chronic renal insufficiency or kidney stones, it asks whether it's kidney stones, other, or both kidney stones, and other. Let's make this kidney stones. Does the patient have chronic long-term congestive heart failure? Let's say yes. Does the patient currently have shortness of breath while resting or with minimal activity? And there's a prompt that says, do you have trouble catching your breath when you are resting or doing minimal activities? Let's say yes. In the past 5 years, has the patient been diagnosed with or treated for cancer? No. Then it asks, in the past 3 months, has the patient lost 10 pounds or more without trying? Let's say yes. Is the patient's appetite currently poor? And there's a prompt saying, do you or your family members notice that you aren't eating as much? Let's say yes. During the last 3 months, has it become more difficult for the patient to remember things or organize his or her thoughts? Let's say no. And then finally, we have four questions about activities of daily living, starting with mobility. And let's say that this patient needs help from others to get around the house or neighborhood. And then regarding eating, let's say that they need help preparing his or her meals. And regarding toileting, let's say that they need help to use toilet paper. In regard to personal hygiene, let's say that they need help preparing the tub or shower. And press next page. On the next page, you'll see some information about the RAI, its documentation, where it's been published, as well as the survival curve for people with different strata of RAI scores. This can help you interpret the values. And then if you press next again at the bottom of this page, it gives you the score. This patient's RAI score is 54, and it again shows you how to interpret the predicted and observed mortality rates in the chart below. So now let's go back to the slides. And I can move here. After the online tool calculates the RAI, you'll want to write the value down in a couple of places. First, write it down on the piece of paper that makes up the survey so that the other clinicians can see it. If you keep the paper with the patient, the score is immediately available to every clinician they meet. Second, you want to record the value in CPRS using a note template, something like this. The values inscribed here are recorded in a way that makes it easy to get them out on the back end for analysis of your quality improvement project. Note that the RAI hyperlink can be embedded directly here into the CPRS note template. It can also be bookmarked on a desktop or uploaded onto a tablet computer, whatever is easiest for you. Finally, I want to say a word about the two scores. Your site may or may not decide to implement the RAI this way, but some surgeons prefer seeing two scores when the patient has a known cancer. You see, a history of cancer is one of the RAI questions, and depending on the age of the patient, it can add a lot of points to the score. In fact, if the patient is young, the cancer points may be the only thing that is making them appear frail. And if the cancer is treatable, by which I mean it's an early cancer without metastases, well then, it may be that the proposed surgery is going to treat the frailty as it treats the cancer. Therefore, when patients answer the cancer question in the affirmative, the online RAI can render two scores, one that includes the cancer-associated points, and another that is scored as if the patient did not have cancer. Both scores are above 37, the patient is unquestionably at elevated risk. But when the scores are mixed, having both near at hand can help the clinicians think more carefully about the kind of cancer that the patient has, its treatability, and its relevance to the risk assessment. The downside to two scores is that it can be confusing. The upside is that it empowers clinicians and patients to better understand how the diagnosis of cancer impacts the score. But it is up to you and your colleagues to determine how you will implement the RAI at your site. It is not necessary to render both scores, but it might enhance buy-in from some of your surgical oncologists. Finally, I want to show you that the RAI can also be made available in the CPRS tools menu, so you don't have to be in a clinical note template to find it and get it working. It's not available directly as a CPRS tool, but as you can see here at the VA Pittsburgh, under the tools menu, we have a section that opens a SharePoint site where the RAI and other online tools are conveniently collected and accessed. You could put something like this in place at your site. So I hope you now understand the problem of surgical frailty, how the surgical pause works, both its process and its outcomes. And I hope you understand the nuts and bolts about how to measure frailty with the RAI without disrupting your clinic flow or efficiency. And I hope you understand some of the options for integrating the RAI into CPRS. These are all just suggestions, and you can adjust them to the needs of your clinic. The best system is a system that works every time with bulletproof reliability. We recommend assessing the RAI on every patient because it is easier and faster to measure it than it is to build a separate system to determine who you should and should not complete the RAI on. And we also recommend the process described here. But because all quality improvement is local, if you think that a different system will be more reliable and efficient in your context, well, go for it. So with that introduction, I hope you might be willing to assess the RAI in your clinic. More information is available on the Diffusion Marketplace website noted here. And if that doesn't answer your questions, please feel free to contact me. Together, we can make a substantial impact in our patients' lives. Goodbye.